Good morning, everyone. I am David Scheffer, a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. I am very pleased to convene this roundtable entitled In Defense of Democracy, Prosecuting Russian Aggression Against Ukraine. On the one hand, we will address the obvious today with our guest speakers, namely that Russia invaded Ukraine on February 24 in a blatant act of aggression. The facts are not in doubt. On the other hand, the challenge of accountability for that aggression, both in terms of individual criminal responsibility of Russian political and military leaders who orchestrated and waged the aggressive invasion of Ukraine, and of the state responsibility of Russia as a nation, is daunting, as the forms of justice are not easily entered. Some of these courts of law exist, and at least one might have to be created. The International Criminal Court includes in its jurisdiction for investigation and prosecution the crime of aggression, along with genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes. The ICC prosecutor, Karim Khan, is busy investigating these atrocity crimes with the exception of aggression as a standalone crime, because the ICC has no authority to prosecute the crime of aggression in connection with the Russian invasion of Ukraine. I will let our guests explain why to an audience that may be scratching its head on that one. So we need to examine alternative courts at the national and international level, and it may be necessary to create a special tribunal to hold Russia accountable someday for aggression. We have two outstanding speakers who stand at the pinnacle of the International Law Academy. I have known and worked with them for many years and hold each of them in the highest esteem. They have had an enormous impact on how the crime of aggression has been codified and how it can be prosecuted in the future. Our first speaker is Oona Hathaway, the Gerard C. and Bernice Latrobe Smith Professor of International Law at Yale Law School, Professor of International Law and Area Studies at the Yale University Macmillan Center, Professor of the Yale University Department of Political Science, and the Director of the Yale Law School Center for Global Legal Challenges. She is also counselor to the Dean at Yale Law School. So she has five Yale identities. She has been a member of the Advisory Committee on International Law for the Legal Advisor at the Department of State since 2005. During part of the Obama administration, she was special counsel to the General Counsel at the Department of Defense. She has published more than 40 law review articles and co-authored the outstanding book, right on point today, The Internationalists, How a Radical Plan to Outlaw War Remade the World. Published in 2017. I highly recommend that book to all of you. Our second speaker is Claus Kreß, a professor of international law and criminal law at the University of Cologne in Germany. He holds the chair for German and international criminal law and is the director of the Institute of International Peace and Security. His prior practice was in the German Federal Ministry of Justice on matters of criminal law and international law. In addition to his scholarly work, comprising more than 200 publications on the law pertaining to the use of force, the law of armed conflicts and international criminal law, he was a member of Germany's delegations in the negotiations regarding the International Criminal Court since 1998. In 2019, he was appointed judge ad hoc at the International Court of Justice in the case of the application of the Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. That's the Gambia versus Myanmar case. Since 2021, he has served as the special advisor to the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court on the crime of aggression. So with that professional identity, he is literally on point today. However, he will be speaking with us strictly in his capacity as a scholar only. Professor Hathaway, I begin with you for about 10 minutes, and then we will hear from Professor Kreß, and then open it up for a more general discussion. The floor is yours, Oona.
Great, thank you so much. Thank you for that generous invitation. It's just such a pleasure to be here with the two of you who are really the true experts on this topic. I feel like a bit of an interloper, but I'm really pleased to get a chance to be a part of the conversation. So I'm going to speak a bit today about the history of the crime of aggression, sort of how did it come to be and why do we think it's important? And then a little bit about how I think we should, in moving forward, prosecute the crime of aggression with regard to the events happening today in Ukraine. So first, a bit of history. As you all may know, at the close of World War II, the victors were debating how best to establish accountability for the war. And there were some who advocated just simply summary execution of Germany's leaders. But the Allies decided to establish what would become known as the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg. They indicted 24 German political, military, and economic leaders. And that marked the very first time that aggressive war was charged as a crime in an international court. And in fact, the very first count of the Nuremberg indictment charged the defendants with planning an aggressive war in advance in violation of the terms of the Kellogg-Briand Pact of 1928, which was a treaty that the countries of the world had signed in 1928 to outlaw war for the first time. And the book that David mentioned, The Internationalist, tells a story of the history of that decision to outlaw war and the kind of broader consequences that unfolded from it. One of them, of course, being the Nuremberg, the decision to charge the crime of aggression at Nuremberg. So this made the crime of aggression the foundational charge of the Nuremberg trial. And indeed, in the view of Robert Jackson, who was the chief prosecutor at Nuremberg, and later, you all may remember, became a U.S. Supreme Court justice, his view was that the Nazis could be prosecuted for the crimes committed as part of the Holocaust only because it was part of an aggressive war charged a war waged in violation of the Kellogg-Briand Pact. So really the crime of aggression was a foundational crime of the Nuremberg trials, even though in retrospect, we tend to look back and think of it for the horrific events that unfolded and that were unveiled in the course of the prosecution surrounding the Holocaust. So in its judgment, the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg declared that quote, to make a war of aggression is not only an international crime, it is the supreme international crime, differing only from other war crimes in that it contains within itself the accumulated evil of the whole. And I think that nicely captures the vision of the crime of aggression, which is, of course, we charge as well violations of the Geneva Conventions, the rules governing the conduct of the war. We charge the crime against humanity and genocide, which are all on the table now with regard to Ukraine. But it's the very launching of the war that makes all the rest of it possible. It is the initiation of that decision to use force by a state against another that opens the door to all the rest of the crimes and that makes it, in a sense, the accumulated evil of the whole, as the court put it. Now, you might be wondering sort of why and there haven't been any other courts created to charge the crime of aggression since Nuremberg. You might wonder why that is the case. And there are two chief reasons for that. First, the crime of aggression really is about the use of force by a state against another state. It's not about intrastate wars. It's not about civil wars. It's about the decision to use force by a state against another state. And the UN Charter was largely successful at significantly reducing, although not obviously not entirely eliminating, aggressive war between sovereign states. And so that's one reason we haven't had as many occasions to think about the crime of aggression as we might imagine. But second, after the Nuremberg and Tokyo tribunals were disbanded, there was no international court with jurisdiction over the crime. No standing court had jurisdiction to try the crime of aggression. And it wasn't entirely a coincidence. The most powerful countries, including the United States, really didn't have a great deal of interest in establishing a court that might subject their own military or civilian leaders to scrutiny. But that began to change with the creation of the International Criminal Court. Again, David and Klaus are really the true experts here, but the International Criminal Court, which came into being in 2002, included as one of its four crimes, the crime of aggression. But at the initial initiation of the court, that was not fully defined and it was left for a later conference at Kampala in 2009 to actually put together the specifics of the crime of aggression. And we may end up speaking more to that today. I won't get into that in these initial remarks, so happy to speak to it if Klaus doesn't. Now, David alluded to this, but I'll say a brief word about why the ICC doesn't have jurisdiction over the crime of aggression here in Ukraine, even though it does have jurisdiction over genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity, because Ukraine gave jurisdiction to the court through a couple of declarations that it issued in 2014 and 2015. That's because at that Kampala conference, there was a decision made in defining the jurisdiction, the scope, jurisdictional scope of the crime of aggression, that unlike the other crimes, it would not be permissible to charge the crime of aggression against a national of a state that is not party to the International Criminal Court. So while Russians can be charged for war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide for crimes that are committed in Ukraine, they cannot be charged for the crime of aggression in the International Criminal Court because of this compromise that was made in Kampala in 2009 to restrict the scope of the jurisdiction for the crime of aggression. So that brings us to the question of what do we do today? There's, as David again rightly said, there is a blatant violation of the UN Charter happening now. It's clear it would meet the manifest violation of the UN Charter requirement of the definition of the crime of aggression in the Rome Statute that creates the International Criminal Court. But we don't presently have a court that has jurisdiction. So what do? There's been a lot of discussion about creation of a new court, and that is really the most likely way in which these crimes are going to be charged. I should mention that Ukraine does have the crime of aggression within its domestic statutes. And in fact, it prosecuted and convicted former President Viktor Yanukovych for treason and for the crime of aggression, for asking Russian President Vladimir Putin to send Russian troops to invade Ukraine after Yanukovych fled the country in 2014. He was tried in absentia and sentenced to 13 years in prison. But there are two problems with relying on domestic prosecutions here. First, international law establishes immunity for foreign heads of state and foreign officials. Yanukovych, of course, was Ukrainian, so yeah, you didn't run into this problem. But if you're trying to prosecute foreign officials, Russian heads of state, Putin, you're going to run into immunities that are less likely to be barriers to prosecution in an international court. And second, Ukraine does allow trials in absentia. As I mentioned, President Yanukovych was tried in absentia. And there are concerns that trials in absentia are inconsistent with international human rights principles that require defendants to have an opportunity to present a defense. And so relying on domestic courts for this purpose does open the door to possible critiques of those prosecutions as inconsistent with international human rights law, which of course, for the first significant prosecution of the crime of aggression since Nuremberg, I think would be troubling for many international lawyers. So the two other main alternatives, and then I'll turn it over to Klaus, that have been talked about is first to establish a court through agreement between Ukraine and the EU or the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe. While this is better than some initial conversations that were being had about establishing a kind of ad hoc group of states to create a court kind of on their own, which was troubling because it creates the possibility of Russia doing the same thing. Creating a court through the EU and the Organization for Security and Cooperation in Europe has a downside of making this a purely regional court, of making it a court that is centered entirely in Europe, that relies entirely on European institutions, and I think feeds a narrative that Putin has been trying to put forward, that this is really kind of resurgence of the Cold War. It's a fight between Russia and the West and not between Russia and the whole world or countries that are devoted to international law and the principle of the prohibition on war. And so a downside of this, I think, is that it cuts out much of the world from the process of bringing international justice for the crime of aggression and really makes this a European project. What I've advocated, and I continue to think is the best option, is to establish a court through an agreement between Ukraine and the United Nations authorized by the General Assembly. There's precedent for this. The Extraordinary Chambers and the Courts of Cambodia was formed in 2002 by an agreement between Cambodia and the United Nations authorized by the General Assembly. And there's also been a prior court established, the Special Court for Sierra Leone, also established through agreement between the UN and Sierra Leone in that case on the recommendation of the Security Council, but the Security Council wasn't acting under its Chapter 7 authority. So the hard part, of course, is getting buy-in from enough countries. We did have 140 states vote in the United Nations to condemn Russia, but far fewer voted to expel Russia from the Human Rights Council a month later. And people have noticed that Ukraine is getting an outpouring of support and assistance, even as many of those who suffered from conflicts elsewhere in the world have at least feel that they have been ignored. But that's in some ways precisely why working through the UN, United Nations, is so important, and the General Assembly in particular is so crucial, because that would create an international basis, a truly global basis for the condemnation of the use of force by Russia and for the criminal prosecution of the crime of aggression that's taking place. Instead of making this a contest between Europe and Russia, it would make a clear condemnation by the world of the illegal aggression by Russia. So with that, I will turn it over to Klaus, and I'm happy to answer any questions about the specifics in the Q&A.
Professor Kreß, you are on deck.
Thank you, David, and many thanks to the Council on Foreign Relations for having me. It's a privilege. It's undoubtedly of great importance to investigate the allegations of systematic war crimes and crimes against humanity in the situation of Ukraine. But the original sin, which underlies the entire current catastrophe, is the planning, the preparation, the initiation, and the execution of a war of aggression against Ukraine. In the situation of Ukraine, the crime of aggression thus constitutes the central criminal allegation against Russia's leadership. Any attempt to establish the individual criminal responsibility for those allegedly most responsible in the situation of Ukraine must therefore remain utterly incomplete without including the crime of aggression. Precisely this selectiveness, however, characterizes the present situation. For in the absence of a Security Council referral, the ICC cannot exercise its jurisdiction over crimes of aggression allegedly committed by Russian nationals. National proceedings, including in Ukraine, cannot fully make up for this shortcoming. There is first, Oona mentioned it, the legal obstacle presently presented by President Putin's personal immunity, but more importantly, the symbolic power of national proceedings would be insufficient to reflect the magnitude of the allegation in question. Russia's aggression against Ukraine constitutes a fundamental assault on a cornerstone of the international legal order, the prohibition of the use of force. In such a case, it is preferable that the attempt to enforce international criminal law is made at the international level. Let me pause for a moment and emphasize that it was by no means inevitable that we find ourselves in the present calamity. In 1946 at Nuremberg, when international criminal law stricto sensu came into existence, as Oona said, the crime of aggression was at the heart of the matter. The Nuremberg Tribunal called it the supreme international crime. It is one of the most important legacies of US leadership in international law that this state has decisively contributed to the creative precedent of establishing aggression as a crime under customary international law. At the same time, the United States famously made the promise to the world to generalize the Nuremberg precedent so that its potential for world peace could be fully activated in the future. The United States have yet to act on this promise, for it was not in line with it that the US, together with the other four permanent members of the Security Council, have powerfully insisted on the most stringent conditions for the ICC's jurisdiction over the crime of aggression. Let me take this precious opportunity to express my hope that the aggression against Ukraine will give the United States, as well as the UK and France, and hopefully also China, a compelling reason to revisit their skeptical position on the crime of aggression and to reclaim their leadership on this crucially important topic. But let me be very clear that the present catastrophe should be a wake-up call not only for the United States, UK, and France. The European Union, including my home country, Germany, has also been far too silent on the crime of aggression, even after the ICC's jurisdiction was activated in 2018. We have recently seen statements on the ICC in which the crime of aggression was not even mentioned. This is an unprincipled position. The same applies to the Coalition for the ICC. They have inexplicably been sidelining the crime of aggression until today, as if that crime was inexistent or of little significance. The first necessity of the day is that this mindset changes. The distinction between three so-called atrocity crimes and a purportedly anachronistic crime of aggression, this should be abandoned. Instead, the crime of aggression and the need for its prevention should become part of the standard vocabulary of international actors in the same way as it has fortunately become the case with respect to war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide. And the second necessity, resulting directly from the first one, relates to the ICC statute. Clearly, the ICC is the ideal international court to deal with the alleged crime of aggression. It is not only a court with a credible universal orientation, but also the only permanent criminal court we have. After long years of intense negotiations, the ICC statute contains a long-awaited definition of the crime, which duly reflects the customary evolution on the subject matter. The jurisdictional regime in the ICC statute that presently ties the hands of the prosecutor to directly deal with the crime of aggression should therefore be revised and brought in line with that of the other crimes. This would allow the ICC to exercise its jurisdiction over the four crimes under international law without selectivity. And not only in one situation, but consistently in the future. Leadership by example, including by the United States, would mean to now help building the necessary diplomatic momentum to revise the ICC statute to such effect. The establishment of a special tribunal with jurisdiction over the crime of aggression in the situation of Ukraine should not be seen as an alternative to the revision of the ICC statute. It should be explored as an additional option in case it is considered that a revision of the ICC statute would come too late for being usefully applied in the situation of Ukraine. In terms of such an additional option, I agree with Oona that the establishment of such a tribunal should be based on a recommendation to that effect by the UN General Assembly, following the example of the Cambodian chambers that Oona also mentioned already. Obviously, it would be demanding to mobilize sufficient support within the General Assembly. But the effort would seem to be worth it. A tribunal established with the explicit blessing of the UN General Assembly would be one with a credible universal orientation. The involvement of the General Assembly would be the most convincing way to convey the message that Russia's assault on the prohibition of the use of force concerns all world regions, and that the attempt to confirm the validity of this prohibition enjoys global support. There can be no doubt that compared to the ICC, the special tribunal could not be more than a second best option. There can also be no doubt that the establishment of such a special tribunal would be unsatisfactory. It was meant to remain an isolated and hence selective exercise of international criminal jurisdiction. But it would be different if such a tribunal were to be established with the declared intent of seeking a permanent solution through the revision of the ICC statute in parallel. In such a case, a special tribunal could play a historic role similar to that of the ICTY and ICTR. It would enforce international criminal law in a situation of dire need and at the same time function as a transition to a preferable jurisdictional regime for future situations. Thank you, David.
Thank you. I had to demute. Those are two tremendous presentations, and they certainly set the stage. I thought the historical perspective and the proposals set forth by Oona are very noteworthy to take into account. And of course, Klaus's reference to sort of the importance of how a special tribunal could in fact be a transition to a more permanent attention to this issue in a revision of the Rome Statute. And as my two colleagues know, I was in the thick of this in the late 90s and throughout the 2000s, trying to determine how the United States could be a strong supporter of the crime of aggression within the Rome Statute. So it has its complicated pathway, but I deeply appreciate the proposals that have been put forth. I want to just ask a few questions, and at the half hour, which is coming up soon, we will break for the audience to pitch in. But let me just ask, is any effort at individual criminal responsibility or accountability for aggression against Ukraine doomed for lack of custody of the Russian civilian and military leaders who may be charged? This is often a question raised by journalists, but I would like to raise it as a member of the academy, so to speak, to my colleagues and see how they might respond to that. Perhaps I could start with Oona.
Yeah, happy to say a word about this. I mean, this is certainly the first question I always get when I talk about this issue. And I think that there are two reasons to think that we could actually see trials like this. So the first, and that we actually could see individual people brought into custody who could be charged with a crime of aggression. So it's worth noting that the crime of aggression is leadership crime. And so you need to have somebody who's in a kind of leadership level, not, you know, we all saw that this kind of low-level Russian soldier pled guilty to war crimes in Ukraine recently. That's not the sort of person who's going to be charged with a crime of aggression. It's going to be somebody who's in a leadership position. It doesn't have to be Putin himself, but it has to be somebody who's engaged in the planning and the execution and carrying out of the illegal act of aggression. I think there are reasons to think that we would see those people brought into custody. I think first, there's been an unprecedented number of Russian generals killed already in this conflict, which is just over 2 months old, which suggests that they're quite close to the conflict and actually, in fact, in Ukraine itself. And that increases the chances that at some point one of them could be brought into custody. If they're actually close enough to be killed, they're likely to be close enough to be captured at some point. And so one of those generals, if captured and found to have been participating in planning and carrying out the crime of aggression, is the sort of person that potentially could be subject to prosecution. And then second, there is kind of longer term questions about the kind of what the leadership is going to look like in Russia over the next 5-10 years. This is not a tribunal that necessarily has to do all of its work in the year or two after we all hope the war ends before long, that it has to kind of wrap up its work immediately. It may be the case that there'll be a transition in government in Russia. And at that point, there could be some opening for prosecution of what is the current leadership that's participated in the crimes. That, to my mind, is a little bit less likely, in all honesty. But I do think that it is feasible that we would actually see persons brought into the dock and subject to prosecution as a result. I don't know if you agree, Klaus. I'm certainly happy to hear you disagree, but at least that's my sense of it.
Yeah, I do not disagree at all, Oona. I'm not speculating about the question how likely or not, but I would emphasize that if we take a longer term perspective, and this is not an unusual, but rather a usual perspective for meaningful international proceedings, as history tells, then of course we need not assume that the regime remains in place for eternity. So things might change, and it is, I think, a reasonable strategy for international criminal justice, also for national criminal justice, to get prepared and not to wait until that moment. It is important to do what can be done now. And I would add one further thought. Even the institution of criminal proceedings as such is capable of conveying a powerful message. I think we all agree about the fundamentally important expressive value. The Russian aggression has challenged fundamentally a cornerstone rule of the international legal order. And in order to prevent this rule from eroding, which we are, I think, all concerned about, it is crucial that the international community reacts meaningfully. It does so by many means already. David has, in his opening statement, alluded to a number of those. But in criminal law, an international criminal law reaction is one of particular expressive power. And the very fact that a decision is taking that diplomatic momentum on a broad basis, as Oona suggests, not just by a few states, but with the endorsement of such an authoritative organ like the General Assembly, this in itself conveys the message that this assault is to be taken with the utmost seriousness.
Klaus, before we go to the audience, because we're at the 30-minute mark, I just want to very quickly ask you to address the issue of state responsibility for aggression, the prospect of reparations in the future. The world community has taken on a huge burden to now support Ukraine in its restoration, if and when this war ends in real time. And that's a huge financial responsibility. Could you speak just briefly to a state responsibility claim against Russia and the prospect of reparations from Russia?
I think legally speaking, David, we can say that after some initial doubt, it is now firmly established that also the violation of this fundamental rule we are talking about today, the prohibition of the use of force, entails the ordinary consequences of an internationally wrongful act. Mm-hmm. And this is a practice that has consolidated this position that under customary international law, there is state responsibility with all the consequences. This is a state practice that you can trace back to the end of the First World War, when a first meaningful reparation regime, in that case, Germany was amongst those against whom it was established, came into place. And then this practice has continued. It is true to say it has unfortunately not always been put in place after violations of the use of force, but it has put into place in sufficient numbers after the Second World War. Then a very important incident of state practice is the Eritrean Arbitration Tribunal. And then, of course, think of the very comprehensive regime that was set up by the Security Council after Iraq's invasion of Kuwait, another blatant aggression. Of course, David, as we all know, the situation there was much less complicated or challenging from a political or diplomatic perspective, because the Security Council was in a position to act and it could somehow activate the customary legal regime. One would have to think about different avenues here, but they come in mind either on the basis of an agreement, should circumstances develop to a point where such negotiations are possible, you could envisage commissions, an arbitration, or even you will remember that the International Court of Justice has recently dealt with questions of state responsibility for violations of the prohibition of the use of force. So the law is undoubtedly there, and it is on the side of Ukraine. One has to await for the circumstances to develop to a point where this, where the opportunity can be used to make the law live in practice.
Thank you, Klaus. And I'm going to turn it over now to audience questioning, and I leave that to our skilled staff to initiate.
We'll take the first question from John Bellinger.
Hey, Oona. Hi, David. Hey, Klaus. Nice to see you all three of you. Thanks for convening. I guess a comment and a question, which is mostly going to go to Oona. My comment is I'm skeptical of the idea of a separate aggression tribunal. I'm really on the fence. I'm not opposed. I, of course, get the reasons why we would have an aggression tribunal, because the ICC can't do it for sort of some of the reasons that Klaus mentioned. I do think it's, practically speaking, very difficult to do at the national level to have the Ukrainians essentially trying to prosecute Putin. I just think is essentially weird. It's not, despite our saying, well, if the General Assembly supports it, it's an international tribunal. It's not really an international tribunal. It's really the Ukrainians prosecuting Putin. I guess my preference probably would be, and this is a second best solution, is really to, I'm also mostly concerned about the fragmentation of tribunals and asking countries to share some intelligence with the ICC and some intelligence with the aggression tribunal, which gets all very complicated. So I'd be frankly surprised if the US government ultimately supports an aggression tribunal. Of course, for those of us who have served in the US government, our government never ceases to surprise us. So part of my question really, Oona, is, you know, as you and particularly David, who has most of the scars on his back, you know, we know DOD has got strong views on these things. So I'd be interested, Oona, as to whether you think DOD would be more likely to support a separate aggression tribunal than to provide support to the ICC. And then the second part of that is, the U.S. continues to have tied itself up in knots about whether they are going to support the ICC or not, primarily because of DOD opposition. I think, Oona, I know you and David mm-hmm. saw the op-ed that Chris Dodd and I wrote last month, you know, urging the U.S. to get over its allergy to the ICC and to support an investigation here. But that would require the U.S. to get off the absolutist position that the ICC can never investigate a non-party and basically get off that. So my second question for you, Oona, is you're very close to this. Why is this taking DOD so long here? I mean, it's now been 6-8 weeks and they're inching closer to it. But, you know, are we going to see a change in the U.S. position on the ICC?
Yeah, I mean, we've already seen some. Thank you for that, John. First of all, it's great to see your name, if not your face, and to have your engagement on this. So thank you so much. So the first thing I will say is that we actually have had like an interesting about face on the ICC. So after the invasion of Ukraine, we saw an endorsement, a sort of a declaration. It was a resolution in the Senate sort of calling for prosecution of Russians, including in the ICC, which was, and it was bipartisan, which was really striking to see Senator Graham's name as a supporter of this, as a sponsor of the resolution. And then we saw just, I think a few weeks ago, Beth Van Schaak, I don't know if you saw this, but Beth Van Schaak, who's the ambassador representing the United States on war crimes matters and atrocity crimes, spoke at the United Nations and what I'm sure was a heavily vetted speech, noted that the United States was going to support ICC investigations of war crimes, crimes against humanity, and genocide for crimes that are taking place in Ukraine. So it seems that the U.S. has already found its way through at least that initial impulse to resist supporting ICC investigations for exactly the reasons that you described. So, I mean, and you and I both wrote probably very similar op-eds. I wrote an op-ed in the Washington Post also saying it was time for the US to get over its sort of hesitancy about supporting the International Criminal Court, despite the fact that, yes, there's a certain amount of hypocrisy involved in that because the US position with regard to the investigation of US actions in Afghanistan, as you well know, was that the ICC shouldn't take jurisdiction over crimes committed by non-state parties, even if they're committed on the territory of a state that is party to the International Criminal Court, as Afghanistan was, or the logic would go also Russia, you know, committing its crimes in Ukraine, which is Ukraine is given jurisdiction to the International Criminal Court, but Russia has not agreed to the jurisdiction of the court. So we've already seen this really interesting evolution of US position with regard to the International Criminal Court in ways that were deeply surprising, honestly, initially, and for those of us who support international justice, really exciting and encouraging. And I myself am very hopeful that this will continue. I think part of the reason that I support a crime of aggression through an agreement between the United Nations and Ukraine is that this is, I think, going to mean that you're not going to have willy-nilly tribunals set up on a regular basis. You've got to have the support of the General Assembly in order to do this. That requires a great deal of political consensus. That is much better than, for instance, at one point, people were talking about creation of an ad hoc court by sort of a group of states that kind of thought it was a good idea together with Ukraine. That I thought was very dangerous precedent for the United States, because if that becomes a way in which an international court can be set up, that does create the possibility that there would be sort of blooming courts all over the place by, you know, a state can get a couple of friends together and create an international court. That I think does create a troubling precedent to do it through the United Nations, particularly for the crime of aggression, where the crime is a manifest violation of the United Nations Charter. So it is the charter of the organization that is being violated, that is the basis for the crime of aggression, and it's appropriate for it to be the United Nations to be the initiating body. As Klaus said, it's not possible to do that through the Security Council, but the General Assembly also has the capacity to take this step. And importantly, with the consent of Ukraine. So that does also create another limit to sort of proliferation of courts, because this is Ukraine accepting the jurisdiction of this new tribunal, supporting and participating in its creation. And that, again, is a kind of limiting factor, because that would mean that you're not going to be able to create a kind of special court for a country, for crimes that are being committed in a country where that country is not agreeing to the creation of that court. So I think these are two really important limiting principles that ought to give my former colleagues at the Department of Defense some comfort that they can support this. And in fact, the big argument that's made against it is it requires so much political consensus. Are you really going to be able to get there? Are you going to be able to get enough countries to support the creation of a court? And we don't know the answer to that question yet. Honestly, it hasn't really been tested in the United Nations. But I think, to my mind, that's the appropriate test. You know, this should be a collaborative creation of the global community. And if we can't get the global community behind it, then it probably shouldn't exist. Now, I really hope we can get the global community behind it, because this is such a massive violation of what, to my mind, is the kind of core norm of the international legal order. And it would be deeply troubling if we couldn't get the global community behind it. But if we can't, then I don't think we should proceed. I don't think it should be a small group of states or even a regional organization that's moving forward with this prosecution, in part for the reasons that you cite. Happy to continue this conversation separately, but I've probably said more than enough at this point.
We'll take the next question from Jennifer Trahan.
Hi there. Thanks for this terrific and timely panel. So I guess my first part of my question, Jennifer Trahan, NYU Center for Global Affairs, would be addressed to Klaus. And we know the US government has been somewhat leery of the crime of aggression. And for instance, I know Harold Coe and Todd Buchwald have written that, you know, something that looked like humanitarian intervention would be criminalized, and all kinds of debatable cases. But I wonder if you could expand a little more on the manifest qualifier, this manifest requirement, and how can this give the US government a little more comfort on the crime that it's really not going to criminalize these kind of debatable cases when, and in fact, the situation we face here is one of the, you know, most clear cases. But I think explaining a little would be helpful. And I also wonder if Oona can just expand a little on maybe the danger of not prosecuting in this case. I looked at my New York Times today and I see, you know, Biden's commitment to strengthening Taiwan's defenses. You know, aren't we at somewhat of a historic crossroads? And what does letting this moment go mean for world stability and moving forward? Thank you.
David, you want me to answer?
Yeah, Klaus, I think you should go first and answer Jennifer's first question, and then
yes,
we'll bump it over to Oona. Okay.
Okay. And yeah, perhaps in doing so, I can, if I am allowed, also partly take up John Bellingham's remarks, because they are in a sense interconnected. And John, very good to hear you after a while. I think what is very special about the situation in which we currently find ourselves in is that it is at the same time a situation of catastrophe and challenge. But as so often, it is also a situation, if reasonably appraised and courageously appraised, that gives new potential. Very often this, in the evolution of international law, that comes at the same time. And why is this so? Because I feel that states, especially states with a potential for leadership, if they sense that the entire international legal order is under high pressure, they might be prepared to reconsider the balance they have struck at earlier times, to revisit priorities. And this is how I also have seen the current approach by the United States government. Of course, I'm not so close as you are here, but I have not failed to see, at least that's my impression, that the US have taken a favorable approach to the important work the ICC is currently already doing, even though aggression is not included, with respect to the situation of Ukraine, even though obviously the court is also looking into alleged acts of non-state nationals. And here is what I mean, or what I meant when I said it would seem to me to be a perfect moment for the United States to reclaim a leadership role, but one by example. And I use these words because President Biden has used them in his important speeches at the inauguration. If this is the model, if this is, and I think it is a model perfectly suited to the United States, then leadership by example means consistency. It would mean that if here the ICC in its activity, including non-state nationals, is seen favorably, then this should apply in future situations which are similar to the same extent. And this should be the guiding stick also for dealing with the challenge of aggression. We now see at this moment in time that it was utterly premature to sideline this crime, to call it anachronistic, to call these negotiations of secondary importance. Now we see how important it was to activate the court's jurisdiction, and yet that the jurisdictional scheme falls short of the necessities, and we have now to move one step further. And my appeal, and now I'm coming to the point Jennifer has made, my appeal to the United States authorities would be to realize that this would be done on the basis of a definition which is not naive, which is not like dreaming of an international law detached of reality. This definition, contained in Article 8 bis, the substantive definition of the crime of aggression, which has been negotiated, as David knows so well, in many, many years of universal negotiations is a narrow one. It is a narrow one, and I would argue vigorously a realistic one. It was only on that basis that it was possible to agree. And the United States at Kampala, they were heavily involved in the conversations. And one point, one crucial point to make this definition narrow and realistic was to include this threshold of manifest violation, which on the one hand includes an intensity threshold, isolated uses of force, border skirmishes of a really insignificant, they are clearly outside this definition. And perhaps more importantly, from the perspective of the United States and other states, this definition is recognizant of the fact that there are currently gray areas surrounding the prohibition of the use of force where reasonable international lawyers can have an argument with arguments of both sides. Just take the situation of, or the question of, is there a right of self-defense in case of non-state armed attacks? Just one example, which every international lawyer knows has been seriously debated in past years. The manifest threshold has been included with the stated intent to keep the International Criminal Court out of those controversies and to confine its jurisdiction to the hardcore. And this hardcore is the center, the target of Russia's assault. And this is why it is such a paradigm case. And I think the United States should not be afraid from engaging here in a consistent manner, not only in the case of Ukraine, but also in all comparable situations in the future. This would be a powerful contribution to strengthening the international legal order at this central point.
I agree with everything that Klaus has just said. And I would just emphasize that my recommendation would be that if a special court is created to try the crime of aggression, that it adopt the definition in the Rome Statute, which was negotiated over a significant period of time. And as Klaus rightly says, is a pretty narrow definition that it requires manifest violation, which sort of raises the bar and focuses on leadership crimes and has been the part of a consensus building process for many years. And I think has real advantages as a result, including Russia was a party to some of those conversations and particularly part of the working group that created the definition of the crime of aggression for the Rome Statute, even though it didn't ultimately become a party to the Rome Statute. I also wanted to go back to a question that very briefly that John Bellinger raised. I realized I didn't answer about the intelligence sharing question. I think that that's part of a broader question about kind of deconfliction between a special court and the International Criminal Court, because there is going to be this question: if you create a special court to try the crime of aggression, presumably many of the same people are going to also be prosecuted in the ICC. And I think this is an argument, again, for creating as an international court, for doing it, likely doing it in The Hague, because that would ease the process of collaboration and coordination. And it's just going to have to be an ongoing process of cooperation between the ICC and a special court. I could even imagine, because this is going to be a fairly confined set of prosecutions, and the crime of aggression is a fairly narrow crime and a fairly narrow set of people that are likely to be prosecuted, there could even be a case for the ICC allowing its facilities to be used for this purpose. And that would further assist the collaboration and cooperation between the special court and the ICC. On the question that Jennifer raised, and I think it's such an important one, is sort of what's the danger of not prosecuting? I think she raises just really the right question. I think the response of the world in general to the violation of the UN Charter in Ukraine has been really powerful and an important marker of the importance of the prohibition on war that's incorporated into the United Nations Charter. There's been extensive sanctions. There's been, you know, Russia has been kicked out of a number of international organizations. Almost every major international court has render decisions against it or is investigating it. And these have been really powerful markers of the importance of the prohibition on war to the international legal order And prosecuting the crime of aggression is really the kind of foot stomping this point. And essential, I think, if we're not going to prosecute it here, when will it ever be prosecuted? It's so blatant. It's so obvious. There's such consensus in the global community that the rules have been broken in a fundamental and deep way. And if that's allowed to happen without that kind of global consensus and this global response, that does signal a kind of erosion of this prohibition on war and does kind of raise the white flag in a sense, and perhaps increase the likelihood that there could be, you know, other countries that take the wrong message from this, not only China for possible aggression in Taiwan, but around the world, you know, countries refrain from engaging in force in instances where they might otherwise choose to, because they imagine that there will be a significant response by the global community. And if the global community can't condemn this, it does send the wrong signal, I think, that international law may not be as inviolate as we hope it would be. And, you know, that creates more business, unfortunately, for the United Nations, for the U.S. military to have to actually, you know, do this immense effort that it's having to do in Ukraine of arming Ukraine, of potentially defending NATO allies, and you know, strengthening international law is a much more long-term way of actually achieving those ends that are in the best interest of the global community and of the United States.
Thank you, Oona. Lindsay, do we have time for one more question?
We will take our next question from David Donat Canton.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm David Donat Canton, the Secretary General of the Parliamentary Alliance for Global Action and also teaching at NYU Center for Global Affairs. I'm really thankful to Ambassador Scheffer and the Center for Foreign Relations for such an important and focused debate and such a high level input. I've never seen one so good in these three terrible months of Russia's invasions of Ukraine. Thank you so much. I just left a meeting headed by Lithuania of the United for Ukraine parliamentary group, very active in Europe and around the world for the creation of this tribunal or finding other mechanisms or accountability. And we certainly would like to see the ICC taking a leadership role. I have two questions. Do you think that the prosecutor of the ICC, while investigating war crimes and crimes against humanity, is already collecting contextual element on the crime of aggression in the meaning of characterizing the war effort as such within which then the single episodes of atrocities are taking place? Therefore, a major work maybe is already done in The Hague by Mr. Khan. And the second question is, a Lithuanian member of the European Parliament said, there is now this trend of saving face escape for President Putin, maybe citing a statement by Mr. Macron, maybe not. And as I'm considering the importance of deterrence, if this would be left under impunity, how would we balance the need to end impunity for this aggression to prevent the future ones, which Russia may even perpetrate again, or how we can we use the leverage of a tribunal proposal or an extended ICC jurisdiction on aggression to somehow give a leeway for President Putin to retreat from the Donbas or other occupied territories? Thank you.
Okay, Klaus, do you want to hit that first? And then we'll go to Oona. We have a very short period of time for answer.
Okay, so then it will not be an answer that does fully justice to your complex questions, but just a few ideas. On your first question, while I'm not privy to what is currently done on the ground, I would just make a comment on the basis of what is generally known from the practice of the prosecutor of the ICC. And this is that indeed, the investigation takes account of the context, the broader context in which individual crimes patterns are situated. This is part of the prosecutorial strategy, how I understand it. And this would, and I I say this in very cautious terms. This was would certainly, in my understanding, open the door to take into consideration that context, because it seems not far-fetched to me to say that the overall aggressive context here is important to shed light on those crimes being directly under the investigation. So that would be my observation on the first question, and briefly on the second. Here, of course, you raise a fundamental point, which is usually portrayed as a tension between criminal, international criminal proceedings and potentially dire needs to strike a compromise, an agreement. Here, my position has always been, and it remains the case, that criminal justice, including international criminal justice, should never be pursued at all costs. There should always be a door open where overriding public considerations, international public considerations can and should take into consideration choices that will ultimately not be for professors, scholars to be made, but for those in action. But it would be, in my sense, wrong to take a rigoristically punitive approach to international criminal law. A door should always remain open. And that brings me to another observation that I think quite often there is a misunderstanding among politicians or decision makers that once international criminal justice as an institution is mentioned or is considered, that this inevitably closes all doors for diplomacy and compromises. This, from my perspective, is not true. The only thing that is true is that all those who are charged with the question of, in the end, perhaps striking an agreement, thinking about a transition to peace, should bear in mind, as you said, David, what an important international value, for all the reasons Oona has just mentioned, it would be not to prosecute. What sacrifice this would mean. So it must weigh heavily on the balance. And you can also turn this thought around, David, and that was probably implied by your question. If the threat of punishment, of prosecution, of investigation is something that could influence already during the time where a cruel, a bloody, a catastrophic conflict is still ongoing, I would not consider this as an abusive effect of international criminal justice. It is also among those effects that the instrument of international criminal justice can deploy. So my, so to speak, in one sentence, be cautious with respect to absolutist solutions. International criminal law as well leaves room for balancing exercises.
I think we'll have to leave it there. Oona, is that okay with you?
Of course.
Okay. So Lindsay, I turn it back to you, but first I just want to thank everyone for a tremendous discussion. I've certainly learned from it, and I hope that this will be available for broader distribution on the website of the Council on Foreign Relations in the near future.